So through your work with your clients and as you're out speaking and engaging with people, what are you hearing is sort of the biggest challenge that people are facing right now in trying to create that engaging environment?
That's a great question, because I think, you know, obviously everybody has unique challenges, but probably the similar challenges for leaders, which are the people that I typically deal with, are really how to connect with and engage and gain buy-in from, I don't really like to talk about necessarily generations, but people who all view work differently today. So it might be because they're of a younger generation or older generation, but we're much more, I think, from when I was in the workforce leading people, it was kind of a very much of a, this is the way we're doing it, and it's my way or the highway, kind of, I think, leadership philosophy in general. And we came from parents who went to work in the factory for 40 years and retired and stayed there because they needed the benefits and the pension plan. And so they didn't have autonomy. Then we came in and, you know, kind of took that with us. But I think today, probably because of the internet and the opportunity to come to conferences and learn and hear from speakers or read books, we know there's a different way to do it. But yet that means now everyone personalizes that and they bring it to the workplace and they're like, well, I want to be managed this way. Right. And I do my best work when you engage me this way. And you're a leader who now has 10, 20, 30 people on your team. And it is really important, I think, to engage people individually. But that's a lot more work, I think, for a leader. And so the challenges that I'm being asked about is, you're telling me, I had a coaching client once who was a CIO of a global organization, and he had 24 executive VPs that reported to him around the world. So he's in Cincinnati and he doesn't, you know, see these people face to face, and I'm telling him, you need to connect with them, you need to know their why, you need to, you know, I gave him some assessments, I said, you should really be thinking about how each person, he's like, with 27, I think I said 24, 27 direct reports, and I'm like, yes. So he actually did the work, and he was profoundly impacted by it, and he made a lot of changes to his team and the work they were doing because he actually sat down and had conversations with them about, like, one person was more wired to get visibility. They wanted to be in front of leadership. And so he was able to give him work and assignments and responsibilities that would get him that. And another person's like, I really just like to crunch the data and I like to do this. So he actually shifted. So once you actually do that work, I think you can get a lot more engagement, involvement, accountability, all that, but it sounds really overwhelming.
So how do you push them through? Like, I'm curious, because I think this is probably, I would guess, a lot of HR leaders wrestling with this, a lot of leaders wrestling with this with the people that they work with. How do you push past the objections? Because I'm sure the objections, like, I don't have time, yeah, or
I don't
never
see
had to
them.
Do this in the past, I'm not gonna see them anyways, or I don't see them. How do you move them past that? How do you move them into a mindset where they get it? Like with the CEO, mm-hmm, their CIO client, how did you get that person to take that step?
I think one of the best ways, at least as both an internal leader executive trying to convince other leaders to do things, and now as a person who maybe consults or advises, is people want to hear other people's success stories. So whether it's me sharing the CIO example or my own personal examples or what your competitor is doing, that's why I come to events like this and stay connected to people like you. I want to hear what other companies are doing, what other leaders are doing, so that when I get that resistance, I'm able to say, but it's been done. Right. And let me tell you how that person pushed past through the challenges. Because it's one thing for me to say, just trust me, or go read this book and this author tells you the 5 steps to do it. But when I'm able to share real life examples of people who have faced similar challenges and either overcome them, and maybe they've created a unique way to do that, or it just gives the person the confidence that the work can be done. Sure. I think that's what I find really helpful.
Seeing themselves in the story,
yeah,
or making it possible.
So you're telling me this has been done before, and so I'm telling you it can't be done, but I guess that's not right.
Well, and there's, I suppose, like, especially when you're working with executive leaders, you're also, like, hitting on that ego a little bit too, that's like, well, if I convince myself that it's not possible, then I don't, yeah, have to try. But once you make it possible, then it's like, well, you're a super achiever. That's why you're here as an executive leader.
Right.
It is possible. It's just you maybe aren't up to it. And then all of a sudden they want to.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. As a mm-hmm, person advising or consulting from the outside, I have to know how you're wired as a leader too.
Right.
So if you are an achievement oriented, you know, take the mountain kind of person, then I can frame this up as, look, if you can figure this out, imagine what that's going to feel like to conquer this thing that you think is impossible versus another one who maybe shirks away from that and really wants the data and the information. Then I'll be like, here's five books to read. So I have to know the people that I'm dealing with as well and how to get them excited about the challenge and opportunity. And I think it's a unique approach, I think, for all of us as leaders to figure out who is the audience, who am I talking to, because we all are wired differently. And as I said, I don't see it so much. Yeah, there are things that are unique to generations, but I mean, I'm by definition a boomer, which I like to claim I'm an Xer because I'm on the cusp, and you know, boomer sounds old, but I probably behave more like a millennial in terms of how I approach work in the workplace because I'm out surrounding myself. What's the newest technology? What's the latest gadget? So you can't approach me like you would a boomer with, you know, stability and what, right. I don't even know right. what I'm supposed to be like, but you have to know what makes me tick.
Right. So that individualization, I think, is really important, really hard. Beyond the leadership style or management style, right? That's, as a manager, we need to engage each person differently. Have you seen anything on broader scale that you think is exciting organizationally, organizational process or technology that sort of is helping organizations sort of amplify that feeling for individual employees of being understood or known as an individual and customizing my experience to feel better for me?
Yeah, I think this is one of those where the technology can be used for good, you know, where we're able to help people feel more connected, whether that's through some sort of intranet or using a social platform or even, you know, we're at the Global Force Conference Workforce or Work Human Conference, they have some great recognition tools. Anything where people can make the workplace feel smaller, even if it's a 10,000 person globally distributed organization, you know, there were examples back in the day when social media was just coming out of companies that were using social media to help employees feel more connected. But today you can find, HR technology tools or platforms that are free to cheap to not that expensive, or in some cases expensive, that can help your employees, whether it's get to know each other, whether it's, you know, share their accomplishments or recognize people. I think there's lots of ways to make even big workplaces feel smaller, and I think the companies that are figuring out how to do that are really winning, because people do want to feel, I know I've read you don't like that work is a family, right? That's not, you're not big on family.
Well, I don't mind it. I just think you have to classify what that means.
Yeah, but to some people, you know, family doesn't necessarily generate the great feelings. Right. So again, know your audience. But whether work is a family, we are engaged in a common goal.
Yep.
So we need to rally the troops around that. And so I need to feel some affinity, whether it's that I want you to be successful because that makes me successful, or we're all in it together. I need to somehow get my team to see that we need each other in order to be successful. And to do that, I think you do have to know some of that. We're talking about that individualized approach, but if I'm on a team and I need to get you to give me something so that I can complete my assignment, then obviously if I know you and what makes you tick and how you work, and I always use the example, people want to buy me a cup of coffee all the time. You know, right. I want to meet you and have a cup of coffee. If you follow me in any way, you know that I've had one cup of coffee in my life at a football game when it was minus 50 degrees and I poured a gallon of sugar in it. I don't drink coffee.
Right.
If you bring me a Diet Coke, I'm yours. I'll give you whatever time you want. Because the people that maybe took the time to follow me or just to see a day in my life, they know, she likes Diet Coke. If I want to get her attention or her time, I'll at this conference bring her a Diet Coke and I'll be like, tell me about you. Let's talk. Let's get to know each other. You bring me a cup of coffee, I'll be like, thanks. That's very nice of you. Yeah. It's great to meet you.
Right.
And I guess I just made myself sound shallow, but that's the reality.
You put in some effort.
I am shallow. No, I'm not. The reality is, if you want to connect with somebody, you want to get something from them, knowing something about them is going to be really helpful. So what tools, technology, techniques can you use to really connect with the people that you need something from in order to be successful? And if you're a leader, you need a lot from your team. If you're a team member, you're going to need other people to help you get done what you want. And if you're an individual contributor, you're still going to need stuff from people. So the more you can connect people, I think the better.
So my last question for you is one that It stems from my sort of love-hate relationship with management practices, as a practice. But because there's a lot of things out there that are good and bad and otherwise, but if I handed you a magic wand right now, mm-hmm. and you could...
I would use it.
Wave it to sort of put a specific management practice or mindset or approach or whatever into extinction forever, what would it be?
Oh, I was going the other way with the what would I choose? So what would I extinguish?
Yes.
That is a great question to really apply some thought to.
Because, we can give you, we have video. You can take a moment and reflect.
I feel like I need a really good answer here. I think that we as leaders tend to too often, and again, maybe it is my age that's showing, we tend to want people to follow the same path that we did. And not just even as leaders. I mean, I've worked in organizations before where, you know, hourly employees at the time were making $15 an hour to do a job that had been there for 30, 40 years. And they're like, you're paying the new hires $7 an hour. And when I started, we got paid 35 cents. And I'm like, that was 30 years ago.
Right.
You want us to pay them 35 cents? But I think we as leaders tend to do that as well, that this was the way I got to where I am. And I had to work hard and I had to put in the sweat equity and I had to do this. And you have to follow that exact same path. And there's lots of ways, I think, to leapfrog through the path, or in some cases, maybe you're naturally gifted in things. And so to, again, recognize that individual's uniqueness, to position people for success, to try to help people achieve their goals, that's what we're here to do as leaders. And so we need to eliminate that thinking of that a career path requires these 12 steps to get to this place. Did I come up with a good off-the-cuff answer?
I think that's a good one. And I think that's, it leads me to think, like, one of the greatest gifts that I think the millennial generation, we talk about all the generational stuff, which I think a lot of it is nonsense, but one of the gifts that millennials are giving us, I think, is just that they are, like, they're willing to speak into existence things like, okay, I know you want me to follow that path, but that path is stupid because it goes out, like, I'm trying to go over there and that path goes that way. Why would I do that?
Yeah.
And they're asking hard questions that I think make us reflect. And like everybody has had those questions, it just that I think some of the other generations didn't know. And
yeah.
So I think that's really, good example.
But I think take some advice from an old boomer, Xer, millennial, whatever. At the same time, though, you do have to do the work.
True.
That is something that does frustrate me. And again, that it frustrates me to some degree. I'm a professional speaker now. You're a speaker as well. And how many, the most popular question I get is, how do I become a speaker? Or I see people who say they want to be a speaker, and right away they are bitter because they're not being invited to speak as a keynote on a main stage at a big event. And it's like, I should be there because I'm a whatever.
Right.
And I'm like, I've been at this for 9 years.
Right.
And I have put in the work, and I've spoken on the small stage. So there is a piece, I think, that comes out sometimes where I'm like, yeah, there might be somebody who sees a way, a different path or whatever, but let's not forget that to really achieve, I think, success, longevity, to be a person that people look to as someone they want to aspire to be like, you have to put in the work.
Yeah.
Now, the work may look different for you than it did for that person or for someone else, but let's not, too many people, I think, want hand up to leap over some of the work.
Yeah.
And the work is what actually makes you appreciate what you have, as well as it gives you experience to share, it gives you learnings, you fail and you succeed at things, and all of that is glorious that helps you to get to where you are. And it's just, I don't think a lot of people have a really easy, quick step to success.
Yeah, no, that's a really good point. It's kind of, what I was envisioning as you were talking is that I think what they're missing is they're looking like that's the shortest path, and it may be the shortest path, but if I think about it as climbing a mountain, like the shortest path, that's going straight up a rock surface, and so there's a big chance of failure and death if you try to climb that way. That's a shorter path to get there.
Mm-hmm.
a lot of other people travel this path because it's actually safer. It's going to take longer. You're going to learn a lot along the way. But when you get there, you're going to still be in one piece. There are some people that can do this.
Right.
You and I have seen those. There are those people that go from zero to superstar because they have some kind of special.
They're a celebrity superpower. Or they're infamous.
Right. Whatever. Something. But for most of us, you got to do the work. That's right. A great point to finish.
Yeah. Or go climb Mount Everest backwards, blindfolded. Then you will be able to get straight to a keynote stage.
I will happily cede my position.
But you
to
did
you.
The work.
You did
you
the
did
work.
The work.
You did the work. You risked that more than I have done. So.
That's right.
Jennifer, thank you so much.
Thank you for having me.
Awesome.